I'm your co-host. My name's Patrice Camano, and I'm from Franklin, New Brunswick, and I'm the Jack.org network representative for the beautiful province of New Brunswick. So if there's any NB people out there, just comment down below, and I'd love to hear where you're from.
Yeah, so we apologize everyone for the delay. Before we kick off, I just want to tell you guys that we're sorry. We're just so excited to get everything going for you guys. And moving on, I'm Sophie. I'm from the Kalit Nunavut. I'm the network representative for Nunavut, and I'm so excited to see you all here. I'm seeing the chat that people are coming in from everywhere, really. Hi, Herbert from Vancouver.
So many places, it's wonderful to see Canada represented. And I think on that note, we can start introducing our beautiful performers for tonight. You want to start things off, Sope?
Yes, absolutely. I'm super excited for the list that we have today. So first, we have JayWood. JayWood is Jeremy Hayward Smith from Winnipeg, Manitoba. What started as bedroom sad jangle pop songs just started singing about how sad or miserable he was. Things slowly started to change as time went on, both style and direction-wise, into the more psych funk sound that is shown today. JayWood carries a unique sound that has been entirely self-taught and manages to combine indie pop with jazz chords and psychedelic feel. His music is heartfelt and therapeutic at its core, but hosts a feel-good dance party at live performances. I am super excited.
And
Up to you, Patrice.
our second performer for tonight will be Leith Ross. And they started making music as a way to digest their own life. They know the power of music as a force for good. So they were sitting in their basement bedroom, thinking about a girl that they had a crush on, feeling alone and scared and ashamed of themselves. Then a song came on about two girls in love. They were so thrilled. Hoping to give that gift to someone else, Ross penned an incredibly honest and intimate collection of songs inspired by artists, including Faith and Phoebe Bridges. Originally from a small town near Ottawa, Ross, the 21-year-old Humber College graduate, collaborated with some fellow students to record the debut EP, Motherwell.
Yes, and last but not least, born in Nigeria, TOBi moved to Toronto at 8 years old with his father. They were the first of his family to travel to North America, living together for a year until his mom and the siblings could immigrate over. The initial culture shock made TOBi aware of his physical presence in social settings, but music was his outlet to express his raw thoughts and emotions. TOBi's childhood mingled Nigerian culture with American musical history, a swirl of East Coast 90s hip hop, soul and gospel music. At 8 years old, he started rapping. At 15, he started recording himself. College studies included a biology degree and working as a youth mentor. This gave TOBi avenues for his intellectual curiosity and compassion, but at age 25, he decided to fully pursue his musical dreams. Oh, sorry, at age 23, he started pursuing his musical dreams, and he's 25 now.
See,
Welcome, everyone.
I think we should get started. We've built the momentum, we've built the suspense. I think people want to hear from our performers. So let's get things started with JayWood. So JayWood, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. Yeah, thank you so much for having me. It's cool to be part of this panel. Yeah.
It's a pleasure having you. So let's start things off with a question. So we've had a chance to chat with you a little bit earlier this week, and we've learned about your life and your musical career. And from that, what link have you observed between music and mental health in your life, and how has this link evolved or changed over time?
I think the older I get, the deeper and more intimate I can get within my music. Like I think I gain a lot of maturity and vulnerability and feeling less scared to like kind of do some deep dives and like talk about certain things or just to broach topics I've never really spoken about out loud. And I think, yeah, the relationship I have with music now is very much like a close friend that I very much trust. So I think, yeah, nurturing that more and just allowing myself to be closer to it. And hopefully that connects and resonates with people that want to listen to it.
Amazing. Thank you. Thank you so much, Jeremy. I just want to say a big like welcome to everyone that's still coming in. I'm seeing in the chat that people are so excited for tonight. JayWood, growing up not really talking about mental health and experiencing moments of struggle in your adolescence, how did you find the process of navigating the different resources out there and finding the best help for you?
I think when I was like a teenager, I just felt like very much out of control of everything. I just felt super angsty and I was like, this can't be it. Like, I feel like there has to be other options. And, you know, that's really when I started to play music and I was like, this makes me feel good. I need to really try to find other things that make me feel good and make it easier to express myself. So I think I just kind of went with like what makes me feel good in like a very positive, healthy manner. And I think from that, trying to kind of build and form relationships within those groups, like I was exercising a lot more. I got really into meditation. I got a counselor. I started writing songs for this project as well. And I connected with some people that I really kind of saw myself in. And I think being able to talk about certain things made it easier to not feel bad about feeling certain ways. So yeah, I took full advantage of anything that was kind of helping me. And I'm always learning new things that make me feel good as I get older. And yeah, I hope that that kind of continues for as long as possible. But yeah.
That's so cool. Mm-hmm. That's so cool. I remember we were on a call earlier and you had just come from yoga or something like that, like right early in the morning. I was like, wow.
Yeah, like yoga classes every morning for I guess like 2 weeks, maybe 2 weeks now. And I'm like, that's how I start my day now. And immediately after I like go to the gym. So I'm like just trying super hard to use this time to be like active and feel less pent up for sure.
Bam. On that note.
All right. So sorry, Patrice. Go ahead.
No worries. I think JayWood, you should definitely play your first song. I mean, I'm excited to hear it. Sophie, how are you feeling about it?
I've been waiting for this. So let's do it.
Let's do it. The song's called Some Days. It's a very old song. I think I wrote it. It was like one of the first songs I think I wrote for this project, which was maybe 6 or 7 years ago. So yeah, I hope you all enjoy it.
Some days I wish I could try. I wish I could touch the sky, but then I don't know. Someday I hope to survive. I'd like to be high on life and be free from what I owe. Oh. Someday to help lives, I want to love anyone can't find the light. Someday I dream I can fly, to look around and know I've gone beyond this world that I know. What do you do when you're half past them? When you're not really sure if your life's begun? You can go anywhere, I know, but this way just isn't fair. I swear I'm not broken, I'm just a little bit lost. With a little guidance, I'll find my cause.
I always mess up this part.
What do you do when you're half past them? When you're not really sure if your life's begun? You can go anywhere, I know, but the sweet decision fair. You can cry all you want, but to the stars and on we go. Cause now is the time when we can say that we can pull through anything. That we can pull through anything. That way you can pull for anything.
That's it.
That was amazing. Like, that's everyday talent to me right there.
Thank you so much, folks. Thank you so much, Patrice.
And the chat is going wild right now. Like, people are loving your performance. But on that note, right before you did your song, we kind of touched a little bit upon how you grew up not really talking about mental health. But since then, how has your life changed since developing the language to talk about mental health and kind of exteriorize how you feel?
I think it's definitely made me a better communicator. That's a big thing. Like, not having a language to talk about how I feel or to put a name to a feeling. Like, I feel like maybe 2 years ago, I really took like, 2 or 3 years ago, I really was like, okay, it's time to really take charge of my mental health. And I like got an emotional wheel taped on my wall just so I can be like, where am I at? And just like know what's going on with my headspace most of the time. I think I kind of tried to like open up more and just kind of work on my friendships a lot more and just allow more softness and communication into my life and like not like run from things as much as I used to. The older I get, the more tired I am. And I'm like, I just don't have the energy to be pushing things away. It's like, yeah, you know, I think being able to feel connected in isolation, as you know, which is maybe a theme of right now for all of us with COVID, obviously, has helped helped me be able to like get through a lot of all my stuff.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jeremy. That's, I'm seeing in the comments, people are loving the emotional wheel that you mentioned.
There's like this, things you can, like, I can't remember what it's called, but like, there's like the, if you allow yourself to like stay in like a rut, you just don't like get out of it. And it's like a list of all the things that show that you're in a rut. And then it's like all the stuff that shows that you're moving out of a rut. I like have all the things on like, where am I at? So like, yeah, constant daily reminders to like give a moment to mental health is super important.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Also, side note, I just want to say, like, I'm in awe of anyone who plays instruments like you guys do, because all the riffs you're doing, I couldn't even begin to think about the learning process of that. So, like, kudos to you on that. I'm really, really, really glad that we're able to kind of touch on your mental health and your mental health as a Black man. And one of the questions that I think I really just want to ask is, how do you think awareness plays into the mental health of BIPOC individuals and their communities?
I think that's like the most important thing, especially now. Like, I think representation for vulnerability is super important. Like, I didn't grow up around a lot of Black men, period. I definitely didn't see a lot of Black people growing up, and I didn't have like a lot of Black men be able to just show like, oh, it's okay to feel sad, or it's okay to like, you know, not have it all figured out. And like, I think, you know, just in general for like kids to be able to see themselves and be able to like see the range of themselves within older versions of themselves is like super important, but also just like with other people their age, I think having a language at an earlier age can help people just be able to identify their problems and be able to work through them sooner than later. Cause I feel like if I knew more as a kid, there's so many things I could have probably avoided, and maybe even who knows where I could have been now. And I think if you feel like there's something kind of within you that you're just like not understanding, like I think I would encourage anyone to explore counseling and therapy. Even if you think you have it all figured out, there's always something that you can learn about yourself. And I think it's almost better to go to counseling and therapy when you're like feeling good, because it's like, all right, go back and like, you know, get rid of all that excess stuff. Because when you're feeling bad, everything sucks and you feel like nothing can be better, and like talking about that will definitely help, but it's also just like a reminder of the current situation. So finding your people as well, like in that, just finding people that you connect with and like a very authentic self, a very authentic version of yourself is super important. And I think, you know, I would hope that a lot more Black kids, brown kids would explore arts as well. Finding outlets is also the most important thing. More than anything, like I think music was that for me, because I just felt very angsty. So like as soon as I like grabbed the guitar, I was like, okay, I can like write my angry Nirvana sounding riffs and just get out something. And like, yeah, the arts really help. I find your thing and use that to help you, and then hopefully with that thing people can understand you. I hope that made sense, because as I was saying it, I'm like,
yes, it did. Snaps to that. Yes, it did. Absolutely did. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. I think we are ready for sure to hear another song.
The song. Okay. This song is called Downtime. It's from an album I put out in 2019. I hope you enjoy it. Where am I at? I haven't played it in a really long time, obviously, from COVID, so just a heads up disclaimer, there might be some blemishes and bumps, but, you know, imperfection.
It's totally fine.
Okay, here we go. Guess it's where I wanna be.
I know I'm always wasting time. It's not hard to see. It's too confusing on my mind. It's always around. I'm losing all but hope inside, and I know it's insane, but I hope maybe one day, oh, one day, one day, I hope maybe one day.
That was amazing. Thank you, JayWood, for performing those songs and also for being so open and having such an honest conversation with us, but also everyone watching with us.
Absolutely. Thank you again so much for having me, and get some sunlight, everybody. It does wonders. Take a shower, you know?
It was our pleasure to have you on. And Sope, what do you think? Should we keep things going and introduce our second performer for tonight?
Yes, 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 of course, of course. Our second performer tonight is Leith Ross. Everyone, please welcome Leith. Hi, Leith. How are you feeling today?
I'm good. I'm good. I'm a little nervous. I haven't, like, done a thing, especially a music thing, in a very long time. But I'm very excited, very nervous. How are you?
No worries. There's no judgment here. I don't know about everyone else, but, like, I'm not as creative. So I'm already in awe of you just because of what you do. So I think you don't have to be nervous at all. Like, we're all just really excited to listen to your music and just be a part of this awesome night. Someone said earlier that the vibes are great, and the vibes really are great. So, yes, I'm really, really excited. So, welcome, Leith. Okay, so immediately, just gonna start off, like, I'm super, super excited because I listened to your EP Motherwell this week, and chef's kiss. So you recorded your first EP, Motherwell, while still a college student, which is pretty incredible. Can you tell us a bit about your project and what was the process of creating this album?
Yeah, of course. Okay, so Motherwell is actually in the last year of the Humber program that I was a part of. Part of it is you have to record an EP and then learn how to produce it and how to release it and send it to mixing and mastering and all that stuff. Basically, like, trying to teach you how to record. So I had this whole plan that I had to submit to my teachers of these three songs that I was going to record. And, like, you have to write out the details and the, like, how you're going to set up the studio and all this stuff. And then we did one session of beds, and then we were going into another session to do more beds, which is, like, when you record the main instruments, the main arrangement. And then about a week before the second session, I was in in a rehearsal with the musicians that agreed to play on my project. And I was like, do you guys want to hear the like 8 to 10-ish songs that I've been writing? Cause I was having a bit of a hard time, like mental health wise. I was pretty depressed and anxious, and I had written all these songs about it to try to like work through it. And I was like, here are my 8 emo songs because they're my friends. I wanted to show them. And they started playing along with it and it sounded so good. And we were like, should we just shoot the engineer an email and see if he wants to try to record these songs live off the floor? And it was very spontaneous and last minute, but we ended up doing it. So all the songs on Motherwell were recorded in the same 3 hours. And it's all live off the floor in one room. There's no overdubs, maybe like a couple here and there, but yeah. So it's very special. It's very, all happened in one experience, and was a summation of a really hard time that I had turned into this beautiful thing with my friends. And yeah, that's kind of how it came to be.
3 hours. That's, I don't even know where to start with that. 3 hours. That's incredible. But I'm also a little bit wondering. So you mentioned a bit of releasing, and then it's a whole industry. So there's marketing and there's brands. So a lot of people use social media to kind of build their brand. In your opinion, how can the idea of a personal brand and using social media that way impact your mental health?
Well, I, from personal experience and just talking to my friends, believe that it can very much impact your mental health. For me, it's the fact that so much of, like, when people get a new favorite artist, they always go check them out on Instagram or whatever. It's become such an essential part of listening to music. I'm sure there are still some people that don't, but I know, like, in my experience, a lot of people that really like my music will find me on Instagram and reach out. Or they'll find me through Instagram and then go listen to my music or TikTok or whatever platform. And for me, the part that weirds me out is that then my music is so tied to the way that I present myself on social media, which not only is that not who I am, but it's also like such a hard thing to navigate. If it's not who I am, then who do I want to like seem like I am? Like, how do I want to present myself? What do I want to talk about? So then all of a sudden my music is so linked to who I am, like how I look even, which also gets really hard being a non-binary person, because on lots of social media there'll be a lot of misgendering in the comments and stuff like that, which also obviously pretty severely impact my mental health. So it's just the fact that I find now your artistry and like in that, like the art that you create is so tied to a presence on social media. So that's affecting how people see you. That's affecting how people consume your art. Like if someone will like someone's aesthetic on Instagram and they'll, and then have that affect the way that they listen to the art. So that's another thing. I just feel like it's way more tied, like a personal image, to the music that we create than it ever has been before. So it's new territory to navigate. And I am like trying to have as many conversations as I can with young people about that, so that we're all like prepared and comfortable and not feeling like too vulnerable without being supported on social media.
Well, without any doubt, social media can have a significant impact. And it's something that we should all recognize, as everyone nowadays is on there, whether it be to promote music like you all do, or simply to use it as a mean of communication. And I also want to point out that we've been told that there is a bit of a delay on the live stream, but we are working hard to make sure everything is worked out. So even if there's a little delay, don't worry, we're working on it. And on that note, Leith, will you do us the greatest honor to perform your first song?
Of course. This song is, I'm going to play two songs off of the record, and like Motherwell. And this song is called Everyone I've Never Met. It's about social anxiety and how I sometimes find myself mourning the experiences that I didn't get to have or won't have because of when I get socially anxious. And it also acts, I wrote it before quarantine, but it accidentally turned into a quarantine bop. It's like kind of a little bit reminiscent, the lyrics of this thing that we're going through. So I hope you like it.
Incredible. Just to quote someone in the audience, am I in heaven or am I in heaven right now?
You guys are so nice. Thank you.
So I'm still kind of wondering, you kind of left me on my appetite regarding social media and how it intertwines with mental health. So I was just wondering, how do you balance between using social media as an effective tool for marketing yourself and also protecting your mental health? And kind of what has been your experience like managing this aspect of your career?
Good question. A lot of it, I'm still learning how to do. Like, I try to limit my time on it, but as we all know, it is very addicting. Like, no matter what the platform is, my brain is always like, you should look at your phone. You should look at your phone. I'm like, no, I shouldn't, but okay, I will. So that's part of it. Try limiting my time on it, even though it's not easy. When I'm feeling really vulnerable about something, I will try to put a lot of, like, make the post or make the thing, and then take a second to think, like, do I really want to put this out for the world to consume? Just because when it's about super personal stuff, it's hard sometimes to, you know, be really vulnerable on social media. And then if something doesn't happen, like if there's not a lot of interaction, then you're like, should I be embarrassed or so that's something else I do. And other than that, talking to everyone that I know that's also like a musician that's trying to balance it being effective and like taking care of themselves, because I know from talking to people that a lot of people have the same experience. So we're all kind of like sharing tips as much as we can. And the problem, I like, just something I want to mention. The biggest problem is that it really is very effective. You know, like I recently got a TikTok account because I wanted to see what was up with TikTok. Everyone was on TikTok. And it's been really useful. Like, you know, I've reached a lot of new people and created this beautiful little space of like primarily gay people, trans people, LGBT people, which is like so nice. Like I've never, ever, ever interacted with so many in one place because the algorithm does that on TikTok. So that's so great. So the problem is you kind of do not, maybe not need it, but it's pretty essential for like being an up and coming musician. And then it also hurts the brain and the confidence. So I did this little study with like around 200 musicians last year, and the most impactful little facts that are like, what is that word? Statistics thingy that I got from it was that over 50% of musicians thought that social media was absolutely essential to having a career right now. And over 50% of them would delete it if they could. So I feel like that kind of speaks for itself. You know, we have to figure out something, because a lot of people are having a really hard time and wish they didn't have to, but feel like they do.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Leith. Not only are you an artist, you're also a side epi, I'm guessing, doing stats and all. I'm losing my words because all the music is really flowing through me today, and I'm just having a good time. I'm not gonna lie, I'm really vibing on my own here. Really having a good time. A lot of your mental health journey is translated through your album, through Motherwell. Do you think your future projects and your albums will follow a similar path? A tool to take care of, explore, and share about your mental health? Or will it kind of diverge into another sort of part of your life?
I think it will always be a bit about mental health. It's always been such a huge part of my life. And even just the fact that I use music so much to learn how to cope and how to also just figure out what the heck is going on with me, you know? Like, I'll be, like, feeling so much stuff, and I'm like, what am I feeling? And then I'll write down, like, I'll start writing a song, and by the end I'll be like, oh, that's what I was feeling. So I'm always using it to process my mental health. Even a song I wrote just last week, or maybe the week before, was about experiencing gender dysphoria when I'm on my period. Stuff like that, it's, like, really vulnerable, but it's very much about, like, how me as a person with a body and a brain is interacting with mental health and then turning it into music as best I can. And the best part of that is then it reaches other non-binary people or trans mass people who are feeling and experiencing the same thing. And then there's that little sense of like community and love and support that comes from being vulnerable and open about those things that are a little bit scary to be vulnerable and open about. So I hope my music will always involve my mental health and those experiences that are scary to talk about, but I think are so worth it to talk about because it creates a space for people who are experiencing the same thing to like, so they don't feel alone. I know I experienced that from listening to other artists talk about the things that I was experiencing. So yeah.
Thank you. Like, I can't get it. I don't know. If you're going on tour, I think you should just take me along. All of you, really. Just take me along. I will go with everyone. I will hype you all up. That's my new job. I also I feel like at every Jack Music, I'm like, take me with you. I'm very good at this hype thing. I will do it. I'm ready to, and I think others are also super ready to hear another song from you. This one is probably one of my favorite on your album, so I'm really excited.
Thank you. Yeah, so this song was called For Now, and it's sort of about, I wrote it when I was at my lowest, and it's sort of about deciding that I'm going to stick around until I don't want to leave anymore, which of course is a is a paradox, but that's kind of the point of the song. It's about understanding that I will be okay and good and one day, and that I can hang around, make some friends, play some music. I hope you like it. My first week back at school, I went to the hospital because my spine was inflamed. My family made the drive at 1 o'clock at night to bring me home again. A couple months went by, I would often cry, told my parents when I stopped avoiding calls. They surprised me then, said they would drive again, till I needed nothing more than to feel like I was small. So I'll stay for now, 'cause I'm tired out, but there's something about the snow. I guess I'll stay for now, just till I make it out. I'll only stay until I don't wanna go. I asked my friend last night if he wouldn't mind driving an hour outside of town. He came to pick me up, didn't make me talk at all, dropped me off, said goodnight, and turned around. So I'll stay for now, 'cause I'm tired out, but there's something about the snow. I guess I'll stay for now, just till I make it out. I'll only stay until I don't wanna go. I don't wanna go, though I can't see it. I don't wanna go, repeat till I believe. So I'll stay for now, 'cause I'm tired out, but there's something about the snow. I guess I'll stay for now, just till I make it out. I'll only stay until I don't wanna go.
One word, beautiful. I mean, just the feelings in that song, it was incredible.
Thank you so much. You guys are all being so nice. Thank you.
I want to thank you for being so open about everything that we talked about, and simply for having such a beautiful voice and just performing for us tonight.
Thank you so much. I'm really honored to be here. Thank you for having me. This is such an important and awesome thing that you're all doing.
See, on that note, so Pate, how can we already be at our last performer? I feel like this virus just flew by.
I don't want it to stop. I just want everyone to keep playing their music because I'm having such a good time. But I, you know what? We gotta move on to the next artist. I'm ready.
Perfect. So our next and final performer is TOBi. So TOBi, how are you doing tonight?
Patrice, I'm amazing. That was such a remarkable performance by Leith. Thank you so much. That gave me life. I'm happy to be here.
And we're happy to have you here tonight with us. So as we shared in your introduction, you've had a pretty accomplished musical career so far. So we'd love to rewind and learn what that evolution was like for you and how has music shaped who you are today?
Absolutely. I started making music when I was 8 years old, just writing poetry and singing along to some of my favorite songs. And I didn't even realize that I was becoming an artist in the process. I was just doing it because it was what made me feel good as a coping mechanism, as Jeremy alluded to. But also it was my way of interpreting the world around me. And here we are now, you know, many years later, still doing it. And I'm glad I kept doing it.
That's so awesome. Okay, side note, for those that don't know, I am a huge fan of TOBi. Like, this is a moment for me and I'm going to take it in. Thank you, TOBi. It's so weird to see people that you like admire on like a screen, you know, but it's so great. Okay. We had the chance to chat earlier this week, TOBi, and you mentioned how your music journey and mental health journey has been intertwined. Can you share a bit about that with the audience? Like, how has the connection between your music and your mental health changed over time?
Absolutely. So a big part of my story is when I was a teenager, I lived with intense anxiety and panic as well. And I didn't know what it was at the time. But all I knew was when I made music, it made me feel better. You know, it just made me feel better because it was cathartic. It was a release of emotions and it was my way of processing whatever I was going through. It was like my diary. And then as I got older and I went to university, I did my undergrad in biology and psychology. And I remember in one of those classes in psych, I believe it was psych like 203 or something like that. And it was on the brain. And we had this concept called neuroplasticity, which talks about how the brain is always forming these new associations and you're able to rewire your brain and your thought patterns. And that concept changed my life, to be real with you, because it gave me hope. It gave me hope that I could change whatever I was going through. And that's what happened. You know, I started going to therapy. I started rewiring those old thought patterns and creating new ones. And my music was always there with me through that process. And it's always been kind of like what Jeremy said before, like my friend, you know, it's the music, you just can't, it doesn't judge you for anything. It doesn't put a label on you. You're valid. Whatever you're experiencing is valid. So that's why I think music is powerful and I'm privileged and grateful to be an artist in 2021. Yeah.
That's so awesome. That's so great. It's actually really funny that you mentioned neuroplasticity because yesterday, the keynote speaker, Dr. Sarah, she also talked about neuroplasticity. So like things are connecting, everyone. Things are connecting. It's so, so bad. And on a, no more talking for me. There's been a lot for me. I think we want to hear you sing, TOBi.
Okay, I got you. This song that I'm about to perform is called Beige. And I hope you enjoy it. It's produced by Harrison, a Toronto producer. Yeah. Oh. I said, babe, tell me how you feeling today. She said, babe. I said, babe, tell me how you feeling today. She said, babe. I said, babe, tell me how you feeling today. She said, babe, I'm just trying to get in your brain. I feel never enough, getting always too much, that's babe.
I remember back when yes was yes and no was no, and red was red and blue was blue and two was four. Now it's X and Y's and hella variables, and X is asking why they cannot get with you no more. And now I'm killing records, make a living off the dead, just like a funeral home. But I remember I was in a threesome with my bills and all my student loans. Hooked up to the four on Roman numeral, my soul was dripping slowly out the cubicle.
Roll up, numb from me. Madness, everything won from me. I came back for loving. Back for loving. Double my dividend. Double my dividend. Just a little babe. Oh, you'll never know. Yeah, always too much, that's babe. If your heart is where my home at, then baby girl, I'm a nomad. You keep on moving ways. You're moving ways. And you afraid to let me pass the doormat. In the past, you've been treated like a doormat. Oh, you could stay. You could stay. Got your mind in a haze. Roll up, love for me. Famine never take one from me. I, for though, I came back for loving. Back for loving.
Yeah, that was beige right there.
That was... See, that could be my new vibe right there. Like, late night drive, I totally just put that on, crank it, and just explore the world. Such a beautiful song, Toby.
Hey, thank you so much. Thank you.
So, I was wondering, what is the impact you hope to have on people that will listen to your music?
I want people to feel seen in my music. And that's why I get pretty honest and transparent with how I feel in my music, because I think it's a bridge to empathy, you know, it's a bridge to compassion. So yeah, I want people to feel seen, but I also want people to feel challenged as well. So, you know, I bring up themes like societal issues in my music, because I firmly believe that although mental health is an individual journey, it's also a collective experience as well, in the sense that we all feed off each other's stories, especially now with social media and how much we use it. We take in so many people's stories and lives every day, and you know, vicarious trauma is a real thing, right? So I think it's a dual process. I think it's a personal process and a societal process as well.
I hope I answered
your question.
I think you definitely did. It was so good. Okay, you can't see my mom, but she was dancing while you were performing. So, like, that's how much everyone was feeling it. She was dancing while you were performing. So there's that. You have accolades from my mom. you shared with us, you know, your experience as someone who immigrated to North America from Nigeria. As a fellow Nigerian, I want to ask you, how has your culture and how has our culture impacted your mental health journey, and does it influence your music?
Absolutely. When I was growing up in a Nigerian household, our understanding of mental health was very, very limited. And I wouldn't even say it was stigmatized. I just think it was topics that we didn't have the language to really speak about it. It was more so my parents thought it was like a spiritual thing, right? They didn't think it was a psychological or, you know, a mental thing, right? A biological thing, a physical thing that could be worked on. So I think that was the toughest part, was not having the proper language for it. But I will say, though, there was always love and there was always compassion and a willingness to understand. So even though I did a lot of that early work by myself to learn these things outside of the home, I was always supported, in which I'm grateful for that. And I think, you know, that's the cultural piece there that I'm very grateful for and happy about. And I'm also happy that more Nigerians and more African people in the diaspora are speaking about mental health in a safe manner, and reducing that stigma as well.
Thank you, Toby. A lot of what you're saying resonates, obviously, because I'm also Nigerian and I think we're both Yoruba, and we have like probably very similar upbringings.
You know it.
So yeah, and like Jeremy kind of mentioned earlier, the importance of seeing people like you advocating for you and also doing that work and, you know, being creative and exploring their mental health either through music or through other sources is very important, and to spread that awareness is also really great. I'm so happy to see I'm having the best time tonight. I don't know if you guys can tell. I don't know if everyone can tell, but I'm having the best time tonight. And I think that it's a good time to hear another song, Toby. I'm ready for it.
All right, I got you. Are you all ready for another song? Let me find out.
All right.
All right, let's do it. This next song is called Holiday, and it's produced by one of my favorite producers. His name's Illmind, and we're going to get into it.
Let me know it's all for me. Looking in your tender eyes. Letting go is hard for me. Let me love you one more time before you go. Yeah. Before you go, yeah. Before you go. Ooh. We greet each other with our eyes closed. We meet each other where our smiles fold. 10 million beats there since we last saw each other. That just remind me where the time goes. Time goes. I'm switching up the time zones on you. Stonemason, build walls up, right? Keep on saying things, how we made out of love and stardust. I mean, us. Oh, you tell me this hard enough, but this warm heart didn't hard up. Too close, step back like hard enough. Hey, ain't no 2-3s on this. Caught up. This all up, tied up. Anxious. If you banged up, pretend to love, pretend for what? Vitachi, I saw your number, I hang it up.
I'm a ghost, grind just some cash. Know I'm down to my last few ones in a bag just to buy some time with you.
Ooh, time to close your eyes and don't say shit. Holiday. Oh, I feel like a holiday.
I do this all for you.
I do this for you.
I do this all for you. Overthinking these meditations, head still, but my head is racing.
race. Gate on, ain't no rest on the quest race. See success, they jealous, ain't they? Deal with the fake, then expect the face. On the way to the top, no elevator. Say this ahead of time like a reservation. Can't stop this shine, I'm sick and tired. Oh, never mind. Take the mask off, don't get a facelift. Feelings locked up in parents' basement. You wrote a wall down like a renovation. Maybe take this trip, might fly away. Take this sip, then lie again. And when these fools want hibernate on the kid, only you were wide awake and I dig it. You ain't the only one who's scared of failing. You ain't the only one with a team or a dream. What I mean, you better chase it. But anytime you need a vacation, I'ma go grind you some cash. So I'm down to my last few ones in the bag just to buy some time with you.
Ooh, time to close your eyes and don't say shit.
I love it. Oh, it feel like a holiday when you're in my arms. When you're in my arms. Oh, it feel like a holiday. Oh, it feel like a holiday when you're in my arms. When you're in my arms. Oh, oh,
oh, oh.
Thanks.
Just amazing. Thank you so much, Toby.
Hey, thank you, Patrice. Thank you, everybody. I appreciate y'all.
And right
time
now,
to go we, on.
We have some time to, if anyone has questions for our three performers, please feel free to send them in the chat. And we'll be happy to ask them on your behalf. So anyone, any questions, pop them in the chat and a member will ask them for you. So let's hear those questions. A lot of comments of support for all of you. People really appreciated the performance and oh, we have our first question. So our first question is from Riley, and Riley's wondering, how do you deal with perfectionism? So maybe we can start with JayWood.
Oh, sure. I think I've never really been a very perfectionist. Leith kind of spoke on it a bit with when you like kind of craft a bit more of like a narrative on like social media just to kind of really put together what you want it to look like. Part of me doing that is just have it look really crappy so that like it only goes up, you know, set the bar low. So it's like I just try to make it look as if I make it look as natural and like easygoing as possible. And I really kind of put that in music as well of just being like, you know what, I don't want to force an idea. If I'm trying to push something out that's not happening, it's like it's probably best that be left alone. So I just like kind of let things flow and just like go with the process. And I you kind of just know when to like the never-ending question of when a song is done, you just kind of know when you're like, this is no longer feeding my soul, it's time to just move forth. But yeah, that's how I deal with perfectionism.
What about you, Leith?
This is a great question. Also something I struggled with for a really long time. I was like, if every single second of this is not absolutely perfect, then I'm going to be embarrassed. But this thing that happened like a couple of years ago that literally changed my whole outlook on perfectionism, so I'm so glad that you asked this, is I was thinking about how when I'm listening to a record or when I'm listening to a live performance or really anything to do with music and someone like makes a little mistake or like trips up a little bit or something isn't like perfect, I'm like immediately connected to them more immediately. Cause I'm like, you're a human being and you've just shown that in that moment. And that makes me feel like you're making music that appeals to me because I'm also a human being. So every time someone's like nothing, it isn't perfect, you know, then I immediately just grab onto it that little bit more. Cause I'm like, I'm not perfect either. Now we're not perfect together. So I remember that. And then I'm like, someone else is going to get that same feeling, even if something isn't perfect from my music. So no matter what, it's good. Like, you know.
And Toby, do you want to add anything on that question?
Honestly, I think those two answers, they kind of said what I was thinking. And I will add on the human bit, you know, I think with AI becoming more and more popular and integrated in our society, listen, that those imperfections can never be replicated. There's no way you can replicate an imperfection. What are you going to do? Devise an algorithm to have imperfections? Like, it's just not a thing. So I think that imperfection is an inherent human quality that I think should be celebrated, actually.
Yes, you're absolutely right. All of you give such amazing answers. Like, I honestly having like such a great time. I feel like I've already said this so many times, but all of you guys are so amazing. Deborah in the chat is asking, what gives you the courage to be vulnerable in your music? Whoever would like to kind of go first.
I'll go. For me, it's all about remembering how it can help someone else. That's the only thing that gets me to be vulnerable, because ultimately it is very terrifying and I'm a very insecure person. So when I get really vulnerable, it is super scary. But like, I got a comment on a video that I made on some social media sometime being like, I was having a really hard day and I was having a lot of dysphoria, and they were telling me about how a song that I wrote helped them feel secure in their identity and like gave them like hope and courage and like to like get through the day, the week or whatever. And I was like, all right, that's why I do it. That's why I open up about these things, because someone will have an experience like that and that makes everything more than worth it.
That's so awesome. Thank you. Toby, do you have anything to add on that?
I mean, it can be tough to be vulnerable as an artist. Well, just in general, I feel like, you know, when I'm vulnerable towards people that I love, I know we have a prior relationship and I know that I'm speaking in a safe space. When you put it out to the world via social media or through your music, yes, for me, there's a little bit of fear intertwined with that. Like, am I giving you too much of who I am? Have I even dealt with the issues that I'm presenting on these songs privately? So, you know, I'm not gonna lie to you and tell you it's all good and it's all easy for me. But I believe it's, like I said, it's necessary for me to be honest and transparent in my art, because at the end of the day, people can see themselves in that.
Beautifully said.
Jay?
Yeah. Beautifully. Oh, I can't wait for everyone's TED Talk. Y'all are, oh, I love this group. I think in vulnerability in music, for me, I think it's always been, I'm just having a conversation with myself. And anytime I put music out, it's just people being led into that conversation. So for me, being vulnerable, I think outside of music is kind of what I'm working on now. And just being like, okay, I've been able to have this conversation with myself. How do I now like move that to conversation with other people? And keeping that same level of depth, I like constantly find myself looking back at like older music I put out being like, okay, I got through that. Okay, I checked that off the list. I made it out of that position I was in. But I think kind of just you want to see connection be made in the people that listen to your music, and you want to feel like, yeah, you're not alone in whatever you're going through. So like what Leith said, you know, when someone can say this really helped me through a time, or this really, really spoke to me, it's like, that's kind of what it's about. And I think looking for those moments to be like, you're not alone as much as you feel you're alone. Like, out of like 5-6 billion people on the planet, like, you're not that special, and feeling like, you know, you're like, you're going to be like somebody else in terms of like whatever you're going through, you know. You're never alone. So like feeling it that way through whatever I make is yeah, that's kind of the work in working on vulnerability for myself.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Jayla. Thank you, all you guys. I just want to say, I think all of you should collaborate on an album or something. Bring it for us, for the people. So we are out of time, unfortunately, from our questions, but we're going to wrap it up with one last one. Patrice, take it away.
See, with so much talent in the house, I'm just wondering, can you all just simply give us one piece of advice each? So whoever wants to take this first, go ahead.
JayWood, I'm gonna call you out.
Damn, darn. You know, I would maybe encourage folks to do more things that scare you in the most safest way possible. I think growth is a very difficult line to walk because it is comfort and it's the unknown. And I think once you cross that line, you may find things are working for you on the other side of that, like being uncomfortable is part of growing. And I think, learning that you're not meant to be stagnant in this life. And I think you should always find areas in which you can grow in. And I feel like I don't want to try to get too deep. Otherwise, I'll unsay everything I said. So I'll leave it there.
Perfect. That's perfect advice. Thank you, Lee.
It's hard to sum up, but I guess be as kind as possible as you can to yourself, obviously, and other people. But, I recently have been practicing that whole, like, what would you say to your best friend? Say it to yourself thing, especially about music and how I present and everything, my identities. And so be your own best friend, you know, be your own hype man. Be like, you have got this, you're a genius, beautiful, magical human with a bajillion complexities in you, and you have a lot to offer the world.
Thank you. Thank you for validating, Leith. Toby?
I would say monitor what you intake through the media, and, you know, take it as seriously as, you know, your diet. Like, what you eat is also what you see, what you watch, what you listen to. That all affects up here, whether, you know, whether we feel it immediately or later on. So just be mindful with what you ingest.
And on that note, it is what concludes Jack Music. So let's just show some love for all of our performers that really brought us the vibes and really just made us enjoy our Friday night. So as you can see in the chat, people are sending you love and amazing comments. And just a reminder for all of our delegates, if you are an early bird like myself and you like a little bit of exercise to start your day, we've got a dance cardio wellness activity tomorrow at 9:50 a.m. EDT for 40 minutes. It will be run by Jack.org's Kayla and Steven, aka Stella. Who teach dance fitness classes in Toronto? They'll be kickstarting your morning with some upbeat Latin and K-pop music. No previous dance experience is required. Just bring the fun and get ready to move your body. For everyone else, we'll see you at 11 a.m. EDT and have a great rest of your night. Thank you for everyone, and thank you to our performers.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Thank you, Jay Wood, Leith, TOBi. It was honestly such an amazing time. I had the best time. I hope everyone had a great time. Patrice and I definitely had a good time, right, Patrice?
Oh, it was my best Friday night in so long. Such a great night. Thank you, everyone.
Same. All right, everyone. Thank you. We will see you another time. Please check out Jay Wood, Leith, TOBi's music everywhere. Have a good night, everyone.